Did you know that you can now use values from HTML attributes in your CSS not only as text in the content property of pseudo-elements? Should you avoid using CSS variables or custom properties in shorthand properties? And should you avoid Base64 encoded data URLs entirely? Find out all about this and more in the next few minutes. This episode is sponsored by Cloudways Security Bootcamp. More on why I should attend this free online event in a bit. First up, Chris Coyer shares some nice examples for the new capabilities of the attr function in CSS. If you're not familiar with the new capabilities of attr function, let me tell you, they are pretty great. Up until just recently, you could have used attr function only to get string value from the attribute for usage in the content property of an after or before pseudo element. So for example, if this data title attribute contained a CSS color, for example, purple, you couldn't use this in a color property because this was evaluated essentially only as a string, as a word color, and not an actual color value for the color property. New capabilities of attr allow you to do exactly that. You only have to specify the type of the value to be able to use it in your CSS as you expect. This is how the syntax for this looks. You pass in type as a second parameter of the attr function, and then the CSS will evaluate this as that particular type. So you can pass in a number here, or a color, or a number of other types that are actually supported in CSS. These are all types that are supported, at least at the moment. Let me quickly show you how this actually works. I will open developer tools, select this element, and I will add an attribute here. Let's say data minus color. And let's specify it as purple. Now, if I want to use this purple value as a color, I can do that using the attr function if I specify the type as color. So let's do this. Background color is going to be attr, and the value is going to be data minus color. As you see, this is not working currently because this value is not parsed as a color, but rather as a string. It doesn't mean anything to CSS, but if I specify the type as color, then this will immediately start working. And this needs to be type and not typo. And as soon as I do this, the element's color, as you can clearly see, changes. Of course, I can use any other valid CSS color, and this will work as expected. Let's try hex value of FF0. And well, this is very inaccessible, but clearly it does work. Let's change it back to purple, but let's use Rebecca purple. All right, this is the official CSS logo color. So this is what we should be using, right? In any case, in this article, Chris shares a number of practical use cases for the new attr function. The only downside is that this is currently only supported in Chrome. So if you want to use this, use it as progressive enhancement or make sure you have a proper solid fallback. Next up, Manuel Matuzovic explains why you probably shouldn't use custom properties or CSS variables in shorthand properties. If you create a declaration in CSS where the value is invalid, then this entire declaration will be ignored. Or in this example, the background color will be exactly this, F00. But if you're using custom properties, then this declaration will not be ignored, but rather it will be rendered as invalid. Or in this example, the background color will become transparent. You can already see in this example how can this lead to unexpected results. And this is even more problematic in shorthand properties, because then a whole bunch of values will be rendered invalid instead of just one, like in this example. Here we have an example with border width property where the entire declaration or all values will be rendered invalid and not just this one, which refers to border right and border left. A way to work around this potential problem would be to always use fallback values for your custom properties. And if you're not familiar with the syntax, you can specify fallback value as a second parameter for the var function. In this example, if border inline custom property is not specified, it will fall back to the default value of 30 pixels and this entire declaration will not be invalid. So beware of using custom properties in shorthand properties, or at least specify a proper fallback for all your custom properties. This week's sponsor is Cloudways and their Security Bootcamp. This is a free online event where you will gain insight into best practices, malware protection, and real-world security strategies. It's focused on WordPress, but even if you're not primarily working with WordPress, you will learn a lot from attending it. Speakers are prominent experts from the security industry, and they will cover a range of topics starting from the basics of security to advanced techniques, of course, all accompanied by real-world examples. The event is happening next week, so make sure to reserve your spot right now. It's completely free, so you have absolutely nothing to lose, but a lot to learn about security. You will find everything that you need to know about the event in the article that's linked below in the description, so make sure to hit that link. So read the article, understand exactly why you should attend, and then hit the register link here, and you will be taken to their landing page. By the way, this landing page looks absolutely amazing. Even if you're not interested in security, hit the link to see exactly how a proper landing page should look. It's really well done and explains exactly why you should attend their event. I will attend this event because it's completely free, and frankly, I do have a lot to learn about the security, not just on WordPress, but in general. So hit the link in the description, register for the event, and I will see you there on March 18th and 19th next week. Thanks so much to Cloudways for sponsoring. Next up, Connor McCarthy examines if you should use data URLs in HTML and CSS. As you probably know, data URLs allow you to embed small files, images, into your CSS or HTML directly. So this means that if you're using data URLs with Base64 encoding, then you don't have to make a request to show an image, but rather it's already inline in HTML or in CSS. The major downside of using data URLs with Base64 encoding is that the files created this way are approximately 33% bigger. That is a lot, and this is exactly why Connor's suggestion is to use Base64 only for smaller images. If you have a bigger image, you should probably avoid using Base64 encoding along with data URLs, but for smaller images such as icons, this can be okay. Keep in mind that both HTML and CSS are high priority requests, which means that your browser might end up loading image content instead of actual critical resources for your website. Of course, I already mentioned the bigger file size, and the last downside is that images in HTML usually cannot be cached. Of course, there are also advantages to using Base64 data URLs, and that is that you can actually use them to improve your largest contentful paint score. Or if you embed an image directly into CSS, it will be shown immediately when the CSS is parsed, and you don't have to wait for additional requests to fire and finish before the image will be shown. So keep this in mind if you want to use data URLs in your CSS or HTML and measure the impact on your actual websites in your actual projects. Next up, we have Who Can Use. This is an online tool that lets you clearly see how different users with visual impairments perceive your color combination. Here you will not only see the contrast ratio and the grading, which are important scores, but you will actually be able to understand why a certain color might not be as accessible as you think. Let me change this purple, for example, and you will see exactly at which point it might make a difference, a negative difference, for users with visual impairments. In this case, you can see that for some users, this will be a sufficient contrast ratio, but for other users, this is not nearly good enough and they won't be able to perceive the colors that you've chosen. A really nice feature of this website is that it also gives you a situational event like direct sunlight and a night shift mode. So even if you're not visually impaired, there are situations where certain color contrast will not be good enough for you. Therefore, make sure to test your colors, make them as accessible as possible, because not only that this affects people with visual impairments, but it actually can affect you as well in some situations, such as you see here, in direct sunlight or with a night shift mode. Let me fix this color so we don't have this problem here anymore. There we go, much better, and I think it's actually much closer to Rebecca Purple, the official CSS color. Lastly, we have CSS Scroll Indicator, created by Konstantin Denners. Let me move it up so you can see it a bit better. I'll change this to top, and let's set it to 5 rem units, for example, so it's a little bit closer to the center. If you're using something like this on your single-page website, you will give users a clear indication that they can scroll and that they should scroll. And this indication not only is effective, but it's also beautiful and very stylish. And you can incorporate it, if you adjust colors, into your design and it might look really good. Or at least take this as a reminder that in some cases, it might not be obvious that the website can be scrolled. Here's a really interesting thing that I want to show you about this demo. This effect is actually created by animating aspect ratio. I actually don't think that I've seen such a creative use case for the aspect ratio, but here it is. My approach for this would probably be to use height property or maybe scale property. And in this case, Constantin used aspect ratio, which is quite cool. And as you see, it works quite well. I will remove this at 25% so you can see that this remains a single dot, but at this point in the animation, it actually stretches and looks really good and really interesting. So this is another clear reminder that to create something beautiful and effective, you don't need a lot of code. You might need just a little bit of creativity. Thank you so much for your attention. My name is Zoran Jambor. I will see and hear you in a different CSS attr function, or rather, in the next video.